Hi, it's me, Dr. Prasad Podilam. I did my master degree from University of Mysore this first time and continued my Doctor of Philosophy, PhD, from VTU Belgaum. For over the past 15 years, I've been teaching chemistry and applied chemistry for UG and PG students. I worked as member of Board of Studies and Board of Exam for two reputed universities. And over this tenure, I could able to write and publish more than 22 academic textbooks, more than 30 research articles, and also handling government-funded research projects. Right now, I am on YouTube, my YouTube channel, My Intuition, dedicated to the chemistry classes as well as coaching classes freely for 10 plus 1, that is plus first PUC, 10 plus 2, that is second PUC students. If you are forwarding this information to the students or their parents after subscribing my channel, or if you are a student, I request you to watch this video completely and share your feedback or any doubts to the comment box or to the number which is given there. So this is class for first PUC, plus one, chemistry, unit 12, and class number 10 of unit 12, quantitative analysis. Quantitative analysis, we are mainly measuring the elements present in an organic compound quantitatively. The main elements present in a compound mainly are, as we call it, as hydrocarbons. Main compound is carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, halogens. Halogens are bromine, chlorine, iodine, can be estimated easily. Fluorine is difficult with simple methods. Then phosphorus, a little amount of phosphorus also may present in organic compound. So these elements, quantitative analysis, are discussed here. So estimation of carbon and hydrogen, to estimate carbon and hydrogen, we need a U-shaped tube with anhydrous calcium chloride. Anhydrous calcium chloride means calcium chloride without presence of moisture, that is dry calcium chloride. It is weighed. So this U-tube containing calcium chloride is weighed. Let it weight be C1 gram. Then another U-tube which containing potassium hydroxide solution, that is also weighed, and its weight is taken as H1 gram. These U-tubes are connected, and a known mass of organic compound, say m gram, is taken in a combustion tube. So this is a combustion tube containing dry copper oxide. Copper oxide will be kept here, that is dry, without moisture, presence of moisture. Then it has to be heated. Okay, so this is the experiment setup. Combustion tube is there, heating panels are there. The sample is taken in a platinum boat. Platinum is less reactive, it won't react with organic compound, that's why platinum is considered here. Copper oxide pellets are taken, and two U-tube, one containing calcium chloride and hydrous calcium chloride, another one containing potassium hydroxide, KOH solution. And pure dry oxygen is passed. Oxygen is required for combustion, therefore normal oxygen cannot be supplied, air containing oxygen cannot be supplied because that also contains the elements. Therefore, pure and dry oxygen is supplied for this to support the combustion. Now, when it undergo combustion, the hydrogen present in the sample will react with the copper oxide. It will be converted into steam, H2O, as well as copper. Copper will deposit there, plus steam will pass through this combustion tube. And it will reach to the anhydrous calcium chloride. Anhydrous calcium chloride will absorb the moisture or absorb the water molecule H2O. And carbon present in the organic compound will be converted to carbon dioxide and copper. Carbon dioxide, it cannot be absorbed by calcium chloride, whereas it can be absorbed by potassium hydroxide solution. So after that absorption, or say anhydrous calcium chloride absorbs a water molecule, weight will increase. Let the weight be C2 gram. And the KOH solution absorbs carbon dioxide, and its weight is increased to H2 gram. Okay, this H2 is not hydrogen, this is weight represented H2, that is the weight of a KOH solution after absorbing carbon dioxide. So let weight of hydrogen produced by combusting the organic compound is H2 minus H1, that is M1 gram. Okay, so first we will consider water molecule, then we go for carbon dioxide and carbon case. So first we'll consider hydrogen. Okay, so this is the reaction which gives the water molecule, which is absorbed by that calcium chloride. Okay, so we know that water molecule formed H2O. H2O, if it's one mole, then it will be having two moles of hydrogen. That is, we call it as H2. So two moles of hydrogen and one mole of oxygen is combined to get H2O. So we can say that one mole of water, H2O, contains two moles of hydrogen. So we can say one mole means that's gram molecular weight. Gram molecular weight of water H2O is equal to gram molecular weight of H. H always exists as molecule H2. Okay, therefore gram molecular weight of H. That is 18 gram of H2O. 18 gram means oxygen has got atomic mass of 16, hydrogen 1. So 2 hydrogen, 16 plus 2, that is 18. And there are 2 gram of hydrogen present. Or we can say if we can, it, instead of 18 gram, if it is 1 gram, that means 2 divided by 18 gram of hydrogen will be there. And we have M1 gram of water molecule formed. That is H2 minus H1, we consider it as M1 gram. Okay, therefore M1 gram of water molecule contains 2 by 18 multiplied by M1 gram of hydrogen. So this much hydrogen is present. Therefore we can calculate the percentage. Percentage will be amount of hydrogen divided by amount of organic compound multiplied by 100. So we can say 2 by 18 M1, that is the weight of hydrogen, amount of hydrogen, divided by M is the amount of organic compound taken, multiplied by 100. So it is written as 2M1 divided by 18M multiplied by 100. Now, case of carbon dioxide case, or say carbon, so C2 gram of calcium chloride, that is the weight of calcium chloride, is increased. So the U-tube containing calcium chloride, it is increased to C2. Therefore, weight of carbon dioxide produced, that is C2 minus C1, is considered as M2 gram here. Okay, so this is the reaction which gives carbon dioxide, and from that we have to estimate carbon. So one mole of carbon dioxide, it have one mole of carbon. So we can say one mole of carbon dioxide equal to one mole of carbon. So gram molecular weight of carbon dioxide is equal to gram molecular weight of carbon. Carbon dioxide molecular weight, that is 44 gram. That is 16 plus 16 plus 12, 44, and carbon, that is 12. Therefore, 1 gram of carbon dioxide will be having 12 upon 44 gram of carbon. So we can say the given or obtained M2 gram will be producing 12 upon 44 multiplied by M2 gram of carbon. Therefore, percentage of carbon, amount of carbon divided by amount of organic compound multiplied by 100. We can write, substitute it, that is 12 by 44 M2, 12 by 44 M2 we got here. Divided by M is the amount of organic compound multiplied by 100 is the percentage of carbon. It can be written as 12 M2 divided by 44 M multiplied by 100. So that is the percentage of carbon as well as percentage of hydrogen. Percentage of carbon, that is 12 M2 by 44 M multiplied by 100. Percentage of hydrogen, that is 2 M1 by 18 M multiplied by 100. Or we can say 12 by 44 weight of carbon dioxide formed upon weight of organic compound multiplied by 100 is the percentage of carbon obtained. Or percentage of hydrogen, that is 2 upon 18 multiplied by weight on water, weight of water molecule formed upon weight of organic compound multiplied by 100. Okay, that is carbon and hydrogen. Now we move on to nitrogen. Nitrogen can be estimated mainly by two methods. First method, that is Dumas method. Dumas method, in which the non amount of organic compound is taken, it is heated or mixed with dry cupric oxide, heated strongly in atmosphere of carbon dioxide in a combustion tube, so that carbon and hydrogen are oxidized to carbon dioxide and water respectively, whereas nitrogen will not react with them, or it will set free. So it becomes, say, 2H plus EO becomes steam and copper. Carbon combines with the cupric oxide CuO to give carbon dioxide and copper, whereas nitrogen combines with the CuO, it becomes nitrogen gas. Then oxides of nitrogen also will be formed, as well as copper will settle down, or copper will precipitate, or metallic copper will be formed. Okay, this is the experiment setup of Dumas method. Consists of a passage of carbon dioxide, excess carbon dioxide you have to pass, and there is a copper oxide gauze. and the organic compound mixed with the CuO is taken here. This is not cupric oxide, and cupric oxide CuO, it is taken in a course, that is cupric oxide powder or loose form it is taken. Reduced to copper oxide gauze is also kept, and it is allowed to pass through a mercury through a cylinder which contains KOH solution. Okay, this setup we call it as nitrometer, where we can fill the nitrogen gas there. Well, nitrogen gas is formed, it will be filled there. So the reaction says that nitrogen gas is formed as well as oxides of nitrogen. Oxides of nitrogen further, it will react to become nitrogen gas. Okay, therefore, these two reactions contribute towards liberation of nitrogen, or complete nitrogen present in the organic compound is converted into nitrogen gas, and nitrogen gas cannot be absorbed by KOH, whereas other compound will be absorbed by KOH solution. Only nitrogen gas will be formed here. A little amount of steam also will be there, that will explain. Okay, therefore, the nitrogen gas will be filling here, it fills, and KOH will be replaced. Okay, so this is the experimental setup for a Tumas method. Now calculation. So let the volume of nitrogen formed here, you can measure with this whatever measurement scale is given there. So that is measured as V1 ml, that is the volume of nitrogen collected here. And the amount of organic compounds supplied, that is weighed as m gram. Okay, its weight is m gram. And let the pressure at this moment, with the presence of that moisture and the pressure of a nitrogen gas collected, here it is P1, that is not at the atmospheric pressure, the pressure of nitrogen at say normal standard temperature and pressure, we have considered here it as P1, and the experiment temperature is T1. Therefore, we can say that, or we know that T1 V1 is equal to P2 V2, or P1 V1 divided by T1 is equal to P2 V2 upon T2. Here, V2 is the volume of nitrogen at standard temperature and pressure. V1 is the volume of nitrogen gas which is collected. T2 is at standard temperature, STP, that is 273 Kelvin. T1, that is the temperature during the experiment, Dumas experiment. P2, it is the standard temperature and pressure condition of nitrogen, that is 760 mm of mercury. P1 is the pressure of nitrogen when it was collected. So it is equal to the atmospheric pressure minus the pressure or tension known as aqueous tension. Aqueous tension is given here. It is a partial pressure of water vapor present in the moist gas. Because steam is produced, it's a moist gas. So when gas is collected over the water, it becomes moist due to the presence of small quantity of water vapor, and that also contribute towards the pressure for P1. So we can say P1 is atmospheric pressure minus aqueous tension. So we can rewrite it. We want to calculate the V2, that is volume of nitrogen at the standard temperature and pressure, that is P1 V1 T2 upon T1 P2. Or we can rewrite it as P1 V1 T2, that is standard temperature 273 Kelvin, and P2, that is pressure of nitrogen at the standard temperature and pressure 760. Okay, so this value, calculated value, okay, these other values we measured. So this one we can calculate and let it be capital letter V or VML. Now further calculation, percentage of nitrogen, that will be amount of nitrogen upon amount of organic compound multiplied by 100. Now we know that at a standard temperature and pressure, we are handling gaseous molecule here. Therefore, at standard temperature and pressure, one mole of any gas will be having, or it will occupy 22,400 milliliter. Or we can say one mole of nitrogen will be producing 22,400 milliliter at STP, standard temperature and pressure. Or gram molecular weight of nitrogen, that is 22,400 milliliter at standard temperature and pressure. Or gram molecular weight of nitrogen, that is 2 times, because it's molecular N2, therefore 28 equal to 22,400 ml. Or rewriting it, 22,400 ml at STP is equal to 22 gram of nitrogen. Therefore, 1 ml, it will be 28 upon 22,400 gram of nitrogen. Therefore, VML. In experiment, we calculated value, that is taken as VML. Therefore, VML at standard temperature and pressure will be having 28 upon 22,400 multiplied by V gram of nitrogen. That means we got the amount of nitrogen at standard temperature and pressure conditions. Therefore, we can go for substituting here. Therefore, percentage of nitrogen will be 28/22400 V divided by amount of organic compound is M multiplied by 100, or we can rewrite it as 28/22400 V/M multiplied by 100, or we can say 28/22400 multiplied by volume of nitrogen produced at STP, that is standard temperature and pressure, upon weight of organic compound multiplied by 100 is the percentage of nitrogen by Dumas method. Now we'll move on to the next method to estimate amount of nitrogen, that is Jeldas method. The spelling is KJELDAHL, Jeldas method. Okay, it has got three steps actually, three stages. So first stage, that is digestion, second stage, that neutralization and distillation, and third stage, that is titration. Okay, we'll go one by one. First one, that is digestion. In digestion stage, a non-mass of organic compound, it is heated with concentrated sulfuric acid and a catalyst. The catalyst is to added to speed up the chemical reaction. The catalyst used here, potassium sulfate and CuSO4. Okay, to increase the rate of reaction. Okay, sulfuric acid is the oxidizing agent, or it is the main reagent used here. Okay, the Jeldas flask. So this is the Jeldas flask. It is a round bottom flask with a long neck. Okay, so here the reaction what happens, nitrogen combines with the nitrogen present in the organic compound, it combines with the concentrated sulfuric acid, on heating becomes ammonium sulfate, NH4 twice, SO4. And any carbon or hydrogen present, they will be converted into carbon dioxide gas that will escape, or steam that also will escape, because the at the end of that Jeldas flask, this is a glass bead or glass stopper, it can the pressured carbon dioxide or steam can escape through that, whereas nitrogen is converted into ammonium sulfate. The second stage, the ammonium sulfate is formed there, therefore it is cooled, the Jeldas flask is cooled, and it is transferred, whatever the ammonium sulfate formed, it is transferred to another round bottom flask. So this is not Jeldas flask as such, so this is a round bottom flask. There it is connected to Jeldas trap, then to a tube connected to a condenser, then it is dipped, that tube is dipped into a sulfuric acid, non-volume of sulfuric acid. So here the Jeldas flask, it is mixed with concentrated sodium hydroxide, for say 40% sodium hydroxide. Then the reaction that happens is NH4 twice SO4 reacts with sodium hydroxide to give Na2SO4, ammonia and steam. Okay, now this Jeldas trap, what is the importance of that? Compared to water molecule, ammonia is more volatile, or it will escape as gas easily, whereas water molecule may condense here. Okay, therefore only ammonia, okay, ammonia can pass through this Jeldas trap to the sulfuric acid, whose volume is taken as VML. Okay, so ammonia will escape as ammonia gas, or it will convert into ammonia gas. Only ammonia gas can pass through that Jeldas trap, and it will goes through that tube through the condenser, where it will condense to become ammonia, a liquid form. Okay, it will mix with sulfuric acid. This is treated as alkali, this is acid. They will react, or the acid base reaction possibly. This becomes NH4OH and sulfuric acid will react. So when they react, the volume will vary. Ammonia will react with the sulfuric acid, become NH4 twice SO4. They will get back that NH4 twice SO4 here, and the volume of sulfuric acid will be used. Not completely, the excess sulfuric acid is there. So some volume of H2SO4 is used by that ammonia. So the unused acid present in that conical flask can be estimated by titrating with a standard alkali. Okay, so by this method, the sulfuric acid was reacted with ammonia NH3, and the unreacted H2SO4 and ammonium sulfate. Okay, so here ammonium sulfate will not react with the sodium hydroxide acid, only the sulfuric acid, which is unreacted there, that can be estimated. We also call it as back titration, estimating the amount of H2SO4 remaining back. Okay, so this titration is done. During the titration, reaction is H2SO4 plus NaOH gives Na2SO4 plus H2O. So from that, we know initially the volume of sulfuric acid was VML. Here it will be changed to or we want to find out what is the volume of unreacted sulfuric acid. So it is easily we can calculate. We know the equation N1V1 is equal to N2V2. We know the standard NaOH normality we know. Volume of NaOH will get from the titration, how much volume of NaOH is added to this conical flask containing sulfuric acid to neutralize that. Okay, therefore from that we can calculate N1V1 is equal to N2V2, or V1 which we want to find out, which is equal to N2V2 divided by N1. The volume of acid consumed by ammonia will be equal to V minus V1, which is V minus N2V2 divided by N1. It's a complicated formula now it is. So let us say simplify. Let us consider as V3, okay, of N1 normality. So the volume of acid consumed by ammonia is V3, or having the normality of sulfuric acid is N1. The normality is also important. Some cases calculate in terms of molarity. So the volume of acid consumed by ammonia is V3 of N1 normality. Or we can say 1000 ml of 1000 cubic centimeter of one normal ammonia solution is equal to gram molecular weight of ammonia. That is by definition. Gram molecular weight of ammonia will be equal to gram molecular weight of nitrogen. Okay, here it is not molecular weight, atomic weight. Because gram molecular weight in ammonia only one N is there, therefore it considers 14 only. Or we can say the 1000 cubic centimeter of one normal ammonia solution will be containing 14 grams of nitrogen. Or we can say 1000 convert into 1 cubic centimeter, then become 14 by 1000 gram. And our ammonia which is consumed, that is considered as V3. Okay, so V3 cubic centimeter of one normal ammonia will be equal to 14 by 1000 multiplied by V3 gram. And our normality of acid is not one normal, it is N1 normal. Therefore, V3 cubic centimeter, V3 ml of N1 normal ammonia will be having 14 by 1000 multiplied by V3 multiplied by N1 gram of nitrogen. That is, amount of nitrogen is equal to 14 by 1000 V3 N1 by gram. Amount of organic compound taken is M gram. And percentage of nitrogen will be amount of nitrogen divided by weight of organic compound, or amount of organic compound multiplied by 100, or 14 by 1000 V3 N1 divided by M multiplied by 100, or we can rewrite as 1.4 V3 by N1 by M. Okay, so 14 by 1000 into 100, that is written as 1.4 V3 N1 by M. So we can say it is 1.4 times volume of acid consumed multiplied by normality of acid divided by weight of organic compound. Okay, so we estimated carbon, hydrogen and nitrogen. Means we discussed, I explained the method to estimate carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen quantitatively. Percentage of carbon, it is given 12 upon 44 weight of carbon dioxide divided by weight of organic compound multiplied by 100. Percentage of hydrogen, that is 2 upon 18 weight of water or steam formed upon weight of organic compound multiplied by 100. Percentage of nitrogen, that is 28 upon 22,400. Volume of nitrogen produced at STP upon weight of organic compound multiplied by 100, if it is estimated by Dumas method. So percentage of nitrogen is equal to 1.4 multiplied by volume of acid consumed multiplied by normality of acid upon weight of organic compound, if it is estimated by Zelda's method. Thank you very much for watching the video. Share your feedback as well as your doubts to the comment box or to the WhatsApp number which is given here. I'm signing out from this presentation. Once again, thank you very much for watching. Please subscribe my YouTube channel, My Intuition, and support me. Thank you once again.